We're all so much better for his efforts. And so we appreciate it, John. And we heard that from Matt Mandy.
Thank you.
Now, on with the program. I guess the MC is going to be Mayor Sullivan.
The mayor, he just got elected.
Did y'all get your ballots? You ready to go vote now? Well, when Jim first asked me to MC the event, I looked at the date and I said, you know, I was planning on a big nap today, but you know, I can't imagine any event that would get you more energized and back into the fight than something on behalf of my good friend, Senator Ted Stevens. And we do have some speakers today, and there are chairs up here. Senator Murkowski, Carl, Jim Jansen, if you guys want to come front and center. Father Elliott's front and center. But anyway, a great honor. You know, we talked about the rules of the game, and the rules of the game when we're talking about Senator Ted from this point on is we're not going to look backwards. We're going to look forward. We're going to remember the good memories of Ted, but at the same time, we're going to push forward with the ideals that he expressed, the hard work that he did on behalf of the state. We can emulate that, but we do want justice, and it's only right that our system worked for all of us, and when the government cheats, we all lose. And Ted was fortunate in a slight way that he had the resources to be able to fight back a little bit, but I tell you, for the average person, if the government cheats on you, you're toast, and that's just not right in our system. So as we rally today, that's what we want to keep in mind, is we want our system to work and work well for each and every one of us, and that's a goal that we should all carry forward. Our first presenter today is going to be my good friend. Well, before we get to that, I just want to share a couple quick stories. We first met the Stevens family in the early 1950s. I was just a little kid, but my parents got to know him in Fairbanks in the early 50s, and then we moved down to Anchorage in 1959, and a couple years later, the Stevens family followed, and we just lived just down the street from each other. So all my younger brothers and sisters were friends with the Stevens kids, and I used to babysit them a little bit, and it's just really, we got to bond and know each other very well. Lifelong friendships were established, and you know, just, I'll never forget, 3 years ago when I ran for mayor, Ted was the headliner at my last function at the Petroleum Club. And because his name was on the invite, there was a line out the door and halfway down the street. So somebody came in and said, you know, Ted's standing in line, waiting to get into the event. And we're going, so went out there and said, Ted, you know, you got to come in. And he goes, oh, I don't want to come in line in front of everybody else. But that was Ted Stevens, humble and just a common guy doing a great job for us. And obviously, real hard to replace somebody like that. So our first presenter today is going to be my dear friend, Father Norman Elliott. And I just have to, I've told this story a lot. He's probably sick of me hearing it. But Father Elliott and I met in 1951 in Nenana, Alaska. And I was just a brand new born infant, and he was assigned there as an Episcopal priest. And so now here we are 61 years later, and we're still hanging out at events together. My dear friend, Father Norman Elliott, please welcome him.
My relationship with the senator goes back to 1952 when he was an attorney in Fairbanks. And he's been a dear friend all through life. I had the funeral for Ann, and his wedding to Kathy and the children. And I dearly and truly miss him. And so I've been asked to give this invocation. Almighty God, we come to you on this day with both anger and sorrow, with anger against those who, anxious for conviction, knowingly withheld evidence favorable for Senator Ted Stevens, and deliberately and calculatingly denied him a just and fair trial. We pray that the attorneys and all persons responsible for these shameful tactics may be identified and subjected to such punishment as allowed by law, and that measures be taken to ensure that never again will such miscarriage of justice be practiced in courts of law throughout our land. And we come, O Lord, with sorrow for Senator Ted Stevens, whose life dedicated to serving his people of Alaska was shattered by the verdict rendered by a jury, unaware of evidence, unseen and unheard. We pray that he may know peace in your kingdom, O God, and may his family find comfort in knowing that he remains loved and honored by all the people of Alaska. We ask this in your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, it's always hard to follow Father Elliott, but if there's one person that can do it, it is our senior senator, Lisa Murkowski. Lisa, I think, was blessed with the fact that when she was first into the United States Senate, she had a mentor like Ted Stevens to guide her for 8 years. And, he was so proud of his protege, and I know how fond she was of Ted and the family, and I think really an adopted member of the family, so close. And there's nobody fighting harder for us right now in the U.S. Senate to get justice for what happened. And I just honor your fight so much, Senator. Thank you. And the stage is yours.
Mayor, thank you. Before I begin my comments, I want to acknowledge some of the Stevens family that are here. Elizabeth and some of Ted's grandkids are somewhere in the crowd here, and we're so pleased that you are part of today's celebration. And as I look out at this hangar today, I see so many friends. I see so many friends of Ted. And I will ask you, where were you on October 29th of 2008? Because if you were a friend of Ted, by God, you were here in this very hangar. October 28th, 2008, Ted Stevens walked through that door. It was dark, it was cold, but it was warm and the energy was high in here. Because by gosh, Ted Stevens was coming back to the state of Alaska, and he was going to stand in front of the people who had stood by him for years, for decades. And he stood tall. He stood tall because he stood for Alaska. And we welcomed him with an enthusiasm and a love and a respect that only comes when you truly, truly have earned it. And Ted Stevens did that. That was October 29th, 2009. Now, as we fast forward to where we are today and learning some of the events that unfolded in that trial, Ted knew that justice was not being served. He told me, and I know he told his family, that this is not right. This is not right. And this was rattling the core of a man who believed in the principles that were set out in our Constitution, a man who believed that when it says Department of Justice on the door, that that's exactly what was going to be delivered. And he believed so firmly in that, that he disregarded the advice of friends and smart lawyers everywhere that said, don't move that trial up. Do it after your election. Don't do it. And Ted said, no. I know where I stand. I know the facts. I know that justice will be served. And I am confident enough in that that I will move forward because the system is designed to help us all. Little did Ted know at that time that that system that he so believed in, that he started out in as a young prosecuting attorney himself, that that system was going to turn on him, and that it was going to be that system and the Department of Justice that would cause him to lose the seat that he had held for almost 40 years, that it was the Department of Justice that brought him down. And to use the words of Judge Sullivan, who said, an ill-gotten verdict not only caused Ted Stevens to lose his seat, but it tipped the balance of power in the United States Senate. Think about what happened as a consequence of prosecutorial misconduct that was allowed to proceed. Think about what would have happened had the judge said prior to October 28th when Ted came home that something's wrong here. Something's wrong with the way this is being handled. Well, that message finally came forward and it was delivered to Attorney General Holder, and on the 1st of April, 2009, April Fool's Day, oddly enough, we got the word that that verdict was going to be thrown out. But by then, the damage had been done. A man's reputation, a passion that Ted had pursued for his whole life, just pulled out from underneath. But still, he still believed that when it all came out, it would be revealed. Well, Ted, it's all come out. And what has been revealed, I think, is rattling all of us to the core. Attorneys who chose not to provide the evidence that they know is required to be provided, exculpatory evidence, a big fancy name that basically says you have to share the evidence that is out there. You've got to do that. And they failed to do that. And as a consequence, we gather today as friends of Ted, as friends of justice, as people, as Americans who believe that when we have a system that says Department of Justice, it's going to be justice for all. And it's not going to be dependent on your title or your economic status. It's going to be justice for all. We need to repair what is wrong within the Department of Justice right now. And I introduce legislation. We will do this. Not in Ted's honor or to pursue that legacy, although I think Ted would want to make sure that this is corrected. This is what we're doing here. We're doing this for Ted, but we're doing this for all Americans. We're doing this to make sure that those fundamentals, those principles, that knowledge, that understanding is secure for all of us. When Ted stood here in this hangar, he said that my future is in God's hands. But he said, Alaska's future is in your hands. I keep this button that says Alaska's future is in your hands, in Ted's face. I keep it in my closet, right next to where I hang my bathrobe. You don't need to know some of this stuff, but the fact of the matter is every single day, I see Ted's face, and I'm reminded of his words, that Alaska's future is in our hands. Let's do right by Alaska. Let's do right by Alaskans. Let's do right for our country. Thank you for standing with Ted Stevens. Thank you for standing for Alaska.
So well said, Senator. Our next speaker is someone who seldom has strong opinions. the hardest working man in Congress, Congressman Don Young. My dear friend, and a friend to all Alaska.
76.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thank you, friends of Ted's. That's a hard presentation to follow. I just told Lisa that's the way you give a speech. No writing, no one telling you what to say, but from the heart. And she did that. A lot of what she said is what I was going to say, so I will repeat some of it and some I will not. You know, we salute the flag. The last words in that flag is justice for all. Justice for all. In this case, there was no justice. In this case, as the senator said, it was an extension of executive power over the legislative branch, and finding a conviction illegally and taking away the rights of the Alaskan people by corruption of the judicial system, the key to our society of a great America. Now, it's hard for me to be up here and say some things that I probably should not say, but I may say. At the same time that my good senator was going through the trauma he was going through, so was I.
Yep, that's true.
And if I could tell you some of the things that family went through and friends went through in the light of so-called justice, you would all go, ah! Because it is not a judicial system I'm proud of today. It is a system that's fraught with dishonesty.
Amen.
And has the ability to take away your rights, right, your civil rights, amen, by an action of individuals within the Justice Department that are very likely going to walk and else we can press this case. And that is wrong. The legal aspect of their bar should be extinguished, and they should be made to pay to every individual makeup. I didn't touch it. For every individual license that have lost, and you did lose, we lost a friend. But more than that, we lost a power in the United States Senate that could stand up to the administration is taken away now, and congressmen, not just the administration, Denali Commission, Railroad, Ferries, Healthcare, Denali Care, those things are being slowly peeled away because Ted's no longer with us because of the inaction and corrupt action of the Justice Department. We have to, as Alaskans, we leave this great, and by the way, thank you, Jim Jensen and Orrin and everybody else involved in this. Thank you for getting Alaskans energized. And this is not about yesterday. It's about what we can do to keep it from happening again.
Right.
You know, this little booklet right here, ladies and gentlemen, is still the basis of our society. It's called the Constitution of the United States of America.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I have to go through the 4th, 5th, and 6th Amendments. I won't read them all. But one of the things that bothers me the most, that all criminal prosecution and accused shall enjoy the right to a speedy and public trial by an impartial jury of the state and district wherein the crime shall have been committed. What he was being accused of never occurred in Washington, D.C. It occurred right here. And what he was accused of was not a judicial matter to begin with. It was a Senate matter about how he collected money and did not collect the money, and it was never a judicial matter. But they made it so. They made it so. And by the way, you can thank a lot of the news media.
That's right.
I lived through this when you were automatically guilty. And I thought under the Constitution, you're innocent until proven guilty.
Yeah.
He was prosecuted and proven guilty prior to any action. Another thing that interests me is the Declaration of Independence. How many of you ever read the Declaration of Independence against King George? And this is sort of interesting why we declared ourselves independent. The king has made judges dependent on his will alone for the tenure of their offices, the amount of payment for their salaries. But he also erected a multitude of new offices that sent hither swarms of officers to harass our people and eat out our substance. Does that remind you of something that I know and is in the White House right now?
Yeah.
Officers out to take away our substance by regulation law. I'm not going to get off of what we're doing for Ted tonight, but keep that in mind. I wish all of you would read the copy. It's a very easy thing. Every kid in school should read this, and every adult should have a copy of this. We'll have them in our offices, you ask them for, and we'll get them to you. Because that's how we will run this country as an America, not as the United States of the federal government. And Ted would be believing me and standing beside me as he did for many years. We had a team you could not ever beat. We have a good team now, we're going to get better. But what happened to my senator, your friend and my friend, should never happen to anybody in this room, and it can under the present system.
Right.
Let's change that system. Yes. Let's become the America I know and love. Yes. Let us have justice for all. Justice for all. Amen. Justice for all. Thank you. I think we all agree with everything the Senator and yourself just said. No two people could have said it better. Governor Parnell could not be with us tonight, so I have a letter that he has sent for the occasion that I'd like to read to you. It says, "Dear Senator Murkowski, I strongly support your efforts to right the wrong forced upon Senator Stevens, his family, and our state. We stand with you to improve and promote justice in the federal criminal justice system through S-2197, the Fairness and Disclosure of Evidence Act of 2012. The prosecutor in our criminal justice system must stand squarely on the constitutional foundation of fairness and due process. The prosecutor has the advantage of first seeing the evidence gathered by law enforcement, and it is the prosecutor who initially decides which evidence is brought to the grand jury and ultimately provided to the defense to prepare for trial. The stakes are high in criminal cases. The defendant's personal liberty and reputation, among other interests, are at issue and depend upon the prosecutor's timely disclosure of exculpatory evidence. Beyond individual implications, stakes can be even broader where public servants' careers are destroyed by prosecutors endeavoring to win at any cost, regardless of constitutional principles and the rule of law. We now know that is what has happened to Alaska's beloved Senator Ted Stevens, and it should never have happened and must never happen again. Senator Stevens, his family, and Alaskans were all entitled to rely on the professional judgment of seasoned prosecutors and the Justice Department. To recognize their duty required them to turn over all exculpatory evidence. That did not happen, and the history of our state was changed by the prosecutor's failure. While I am very disturbed, it would take legislation to require federal prosecutors to perform a fundamental duty of fairness. I'm also concerned about the lack of discipline applied the prosecutors for failing to uphold their duty. Please urge the chairman of the Senate Judiciary Committee, Senator Leahy, to schedule S-2197, hold hearings, and pass the bill through the committee. Sincerely, Sean Parnell, Governor." Well, our next speaker is a friend to all Alaskans, certainly a great, great business leader, and a longtime friend of Senator Ted Stevens and his family, Jim Jansen.
Well, I prepared a few remarks, but it's really all been said, and so very, very well. But I do want to say this. October 28th, 2008, I remember being right here in this building. Many, many of you were here, but I remember so well Senator Murkowski, Don Young was here, and I remember you being on the stage and standing with Ted Stevens, arm in arm, supporting him at his time of need. And that was a time when not everybody stood with him. Many of our Alaskans, some of our leaders turned on him, Many in the Senate turned on him, but you were there, and I will never forget that. Thank you so much. This legislative change that is so important requires bipartisan support. It's just the nature of Washington, D.C. But Ted's friends in the Senate, specifically Senator Inouye, his brother and his best friend, co-sponsored the bill with Senator Murkowski. And I was asked tonight to say a few words for Senator Begich. And Senator Begich also is supporting this legislation. He says, thanks to the organizers of the Rally for Justice, I'm sorry I could not join you, so thank you, Jim, for expressing my sentiments. There is no question that Senator Stevens' legacy of accomplishment for our state is enormous. It is especially troubling that a person of his stature did not get a fair hearing in the criminal justice system. Every American, regardless of their station in life, deserves a fair trial and equal treatment from the judicial system. That's why I am pleased to co-sponsor Senator Murkowski's Fairness in Disclosure Evidence Act of 2012. This legislation will help level the playing field and ensure that all citizens, whether United States senators or an average American, are treated fairly and given the opportunity to confront the evidence against them. We must increase the public's confidence in government and help citizens trust that the system of justice is working properly for everyone. Sincerely, Mark Begich. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. As we all know, Senator Stevens was a tireless leader on behalf of all Alaskans, particularly in rural Alaska, fighting for infrastructure for areas that even to this day do not have the basic infrastructure that we take for granted. His work on ANCSA, the Trans-Alaska Pipeline, the fight that he did for Alaska Native community year after year was legendary. And to speak to that, his good friend Carl Mars.
Well, when JJ asked me to say a few words, I spent just a couple days ago, I spent a lot of time thinking about what I was going to say, and then you two get up and say it all. So I'm going to say it again. I guess, you know, there's not a whole lot that hasn't been said about Ted. Other than, like you, I'm angry about the way the senator was treated by the system that he really believed in. Ted was my friend, as he was of many of you. Ted loved life, he loved his family, he loved his job as our U.S. Senator, and he was damn good at it. He loved to fish, play cards, have a good cigar once in a while, and loved a good glass of red wine. Most of all, Ted was above reproach. He was as honest as the years are long, and he would do most anything to help Alaskans of all walks of life. And never, never asking anything in return for himself. When Ted was going through his ordeal, and many others, I and many others, asked him to delay the trial. He thought if he could delay it, change the venue, bring it to Alaska, and get a fair trial. In our opinion, that was what we thought he needed to do. His response to us always was, he trusted the justice system. And he had nothing to worry about because he did nothing wrong. I don't think there's anyone that was more stunned by the verdict that was handed down
than Ted Stevens. When someone as honest as Ted could be railroaded as badly by our system of justice, it's time to change the system and the people running. So I ask you to support our senior senator, Lisa Murkowski, in a request for legislation so this can't happen again. No matter what the Justice Department is saying, that is, that this is just an isolated case, but it's happening far too often throughout the nation to many people that can't afford to fight it. The feds are out of control. It was Ted Stevens and his counsel that withheld critical evidence from the feds. Guess where they'd be? They'd all be behind jail bars. So how come the agents in this case are not being prosecuted? Why are they being protected by the same agency that allowed and may have encouraged them to pull these kinds of illegal tactics? Now, changing the direction a little bit, we can't forget where this all started. It was Bill Allen, the man. The man did more harm to Ted and his family, more harm to the people of the good state of Alaska, than anyone else involved. And we tend to forget that. You know, he lied through his teeth to save himself while letting his supposedly good friend hang. I believe whatever the deal that the feds forced the state of Alaska into not to prosecute under state law should be null and void. The state should go after Bill Allen. He was a linchpin. He was a linchpin behind all of us. And he's guiltier than the federal agents involved. So it's all right to lie if you do it with a federal sanction. You only get your hand slapped for that. Whatever the federal government did to coerce the state to take a back seat on the issues involving Bill Allen were wrong. And the state should not have, and they should not have to live up to the deal held together by lies, by out of control agents of Bill Allen. So they could go after Ted and others with their own form of vendetta. Look at the damage Bill Allen did to the Stevens family and to Ben Stevens in particular. Ben is very much like his dad, with the same great character, integrity, and honesty. Ben was just trying to follow in his dad's footsteps. Yet by the lying word of one man, the feds were able to ruin Ben's political career. I believe that the state has an obligation and a duty to go after Bill Allen. I don't think it's all about prosecuting. You know, there are many others that reputations were tainted or ruined by these prosecutors. They were harmed, had to hire lawyers, spent thousands of dollars to defend themselves against out-of-control government, hell-bent on a campaign to ruin Alaska's most valued citizen, Ted Stevens, my good friend and yours. Those agents and Bill should not get away with this tragedy. They need to be punished for their bad deeds. It may sound like I'm a little upset, Well, I'm mad as hell at the way the federal government treated a man that spent most of his working and life and caring for a country, and above all, always held the United States of America as close to his heart as he held his family. Thank you.
Support to Senator Murkowski's bill, and we're doing it through an open letter that will go to the committees that will be considering the bill and to all the senators and all the congressmen. So how many of you have not yet signed this open letter? Okay. On the tables that you see to the left and the right are copies of the open letter with pens, and I need every single person in this room to sign this letter before you leave tonight. And here, I'm just going to give you some of the key points on it. It's entitled, Every American Deserves a Fair Trial. And in the middle it reads, as citizens of Alaska and the United States, we urge you, as chief law enforcement officer of the federal government, to fulfill your oath to support and defend the Constitution. We demand that you fire the deceitful and corrupt prosecutors and investigators identified in the special counsel's report and terminate further government funding of their legal expenses. Initiate, using an independent counsel, a full criminal investigation into the conduct of the prosecutors and investigators, and request the bar associations in which there are members to open disbarment proceedings. Publicly release the complete text of the upcoming Office of Professional Responsibility report on the Stevens prosecution, and maybe most importantly, apologize to Catherine Stevens and the other members of the Stevens family and the people of Alaska. They need to sign this letter.